Second election by Ted Johnson.
I've left the last slide where we were before lunch. Basically, mind you, what we had done is we had found a normal complete block system. Well, we conjugated the conjugate. Everything now lives inside a transitive P group that contains Z squared L, and that has a normal complete block system with blocks of size P. The problem is that for computational purposes, we would like it to be a nice block system, and we don't know that it is. So what we need to do now is see how to make it the block system that we want it to be, and I want it to be this block system here. So the blocks are the cosets of the subgroup generated by 0, 1. All right, and it turns out that we're going to use this useful trick, and this isn't hard at all. What one can think of ZP squared as a vector space in the obvious way. I know some people are going to get excited because I use ZP there instead of the field of order P, but that would just seem to clog the notation if we have to identify ZP with FT in the obvious way. So I'm just going to use ZP as a field if I would like it to be a field, because it acts like a field here. We can think of ZP squared as a vector space in the obvious way, and there's a linear transformation that will map any one-dimensional subspace to any other one-dimensional subspace. So there's a linear transformation alpha of ZP squared, which maps the subgroup H, whose cosets form the block system I have, to this one-dimensional subspace generated by 0, 1. And that's a linear transformation. Of course, this is just another way of saying it's a group automorphism. That works. And so replacing delta with delta alpha, or if you want to think of this in terms of conjugation, we're going to be conjugating delta inverse ZP squared L delta by alpha, and remembering that when we conjugate alpha, it replaces the orbits of HL with their image under alpha by this useful trick. We can assume without loss of generality that our complete block system consists of cosets of the subgroup that we want, generated by 0, 1. So this is just a nice trick. Typically, this trick is going to work. If you have various choices, then there are some nice theorems about how to get automorphisms that will map nice subgroups to nice subgroups. Okay. Now we're going to apply lemma 52. This is the lemma from the equivalence relation that we, not from the equivalence relation, it will tell us what? That if we're living in the automorphism group of a graph, then what? We have one of two things. Either the kernel has order P, or I'm actually looking at a wreath product. To the CLP subgroup P1, and so we can conclude that either this fixer has order P, or the gamma is isomorphic to a wreath product of two circular digraphs of order P. I guess I'm supposed to pause here and do some sort of da-da-da, because that's a graph theoretic lemma, and that is the graph theory in this proof. Okay. Well, let's take the first case, because it's the easy one. If the fixer has order P, then P1 has to have order P squared, because what? Its quotient by the blocks lives in SP. It's a P group, so it has order P. Kernel has order P, so the whole thing has order P squared. And that just means that delta inverse ZP squared L delta is P squared L. My P1 is just the left regular representation. Yeah, so we're finished with that case. So all we have left to deal with is the gamma is isomorphic to a wreath product and circular digraphs of order P. Now, in this case, we know what P1 is because we know that ZPL, wreath ZPL, is contained in the automorphism group of our gamma. And we know what ZPL, wreath ZPL is. It's this group here. We saw that as an example, and we know that it's a CLOP subgroup of SP squared. So P1, which was its original CLOP subgroup that contained ZP squared L, that's it. Yeah. So we know what P1 is. Before we move on, I was saying that this was the only place where we were going to use some graph theory. Basically what the argument says is that with vertex transitive digraphs, your CLOP subgroup is either going to be as small as possible, because you know it has order P squared, because it contains ZP squared L, or it's as big as possible, a full CLOP subgroup of SP squared. So you see all with me? So in the graph case, the CLOP subgroup is either as big as possible or as small as possible. For other combinatorial objects, it very well may live in between, and it is known that none of those will give you CI. So if your CLOP subgroup is not one of the two extremes, they're going to be non-conjugate regular subgroups isomorphic to ZP equals ZP. Okay? Alright. Nicely. If you go back and look at these things, I actually have equality here. The embedding theorem, for example, we already knew that our CLOP subgroup was contained in a subgroup isomorphic to ZP read ZP, which actually looks like that. But it's our making sure that the Bloch system was the natural one that actually gives me equality. Now, we played this game with gamma. We can play this game with aught gamma. We can play the same sort of game with its image. And if you look at a CLOP subgroup of the image, it's got blocks of size P by the same argument, and then I can straighten those out and make them what I want. So I can assume that P1 is a CLOP subgroup not just of gamma, but of aught gamma, but also of aught delta gamma, the image. Okay, so let's do a little bit more conjugation. Once we have that P1 is contained in there, we know that delta inverse P1 delta is in the automorphism group of gamma, and we know it's a CLOP subgroup because it has the right order. So I can conjugate. So I can assume that delta inverse P1 delta is P1. So delta normalized. All right. So why do I care about this? What I'm going to do now is, do y'all like computations? I typically don't like them too much. It's not that I dislike them. It's that when I compute things, it's very easy to make a mistake and then sort of go on and do two or three more pages of work and then come back and find out that the computation is wrong. You have to do two or three pages. So what I'm going to try to do here is avoid, put off computations as long as possible. We're eventually going to have to do all of the computations that one has to do, but we don't have to do them all yet. So what I'm going to do is instead of conjugating, I'm going to sort of shift my focus from the conjugacy classes to regular subgroups, isomorphic to Z cross ZP, to delta. And what this whole idea of conjugation by delta and then conjugating it, what happens when you conjugate? You're replacing your delta by this nicer, hopefully, isomorphism. So here, instead of playing with the conjugates and implicitly get a changing delta. I'm going to play with delta, and I'm going to see if I can figure out what it is. And that's actually going to help me quite a bit. Make life a little bit easier. Okay, so how do we do this? So P1 is a CLP subgroup of S ZP squared. It contains a regular cyclic subgroup. We talked about that, right? If you've got, we've got our CLP subgroup. It contains ZP squared L. There's a regular cyclic subgroup. It's contained in a P subgroup. I can conjugate, and that means that, okay, maybe I don't have ZP squared L in there, but I have a regular subgroup isomorphic to it. And I want to focus on that for just a minute, because that will tell me that the block system that I have is the only one of P1 with blocks of size P. Because while ZP cross ZPL contains P plus 1 subgroups of order P, ZP squared L has only 1. Okay? So I have a unique complete block system with blocks of size P. Well, this is going to tell me something, because the blocks in gamma and the blocks in delta gamma are the same blocks, and they're unique. And so when you conjugate delta, that replaces this orbit of HL with their images under delta, and what these images are the same. And what that tells me is that delta actually maps the complete block system to itself. So now I've got, because of the uniqueness. Now in general, that's not going to be true. If you have different block systems, it can map a block system to a different block system. So not a problem here. The embedding theorem is then going to tell me, since delta preserves these blocks of script B, my delta actually lives in SP wreath SP. We can do quite a bit better, because the quotient delta mod B, it normalizes ZP squared L mod B, and that's just ZP L. And that tells me that on the blocks, delta has to be an element of AGL1P. It normalizes the P cycle. And so my delta looks like that. We can play this exact same game with the kernel of the action on the blocks. So similarly, delta normalizes the fixer, which is just isomorphic to ZPL raised to the P power. And so delta is going to live in AGL1P wreath AGL1P. Okay? So here's what delta looks like. Delta by J, in the first coordinate, it's going to multiply by something in ZP star, and then it's going to add something. Now in the second coordinate, notice I have this subscript right there, N sub I. I know that, on a block, it normalizes ZPL as it takes a block to a block, but I don't have any idea that it does the same thing with each block. So right now, it can do what it likes independently on the blocks, so I really do have that it's N sub I of J plus B sub I. N sub I, of course, is in ZP star because it's a multiplier, and B sub I is in ZP. Seem okay? And I like to think of this as, I've just reached a point where I'm going to start to whittle down what the,
whittle.
You know, get a piece of wood, a knife, and make a turkey or a, something. I just make steaks, that's all I can do. Actually, usually I just cut my hand. But that's the expression in English. We've got this thing inside the piece of wood, and we're just sort of chipping away at it and making it better and more useful. All right, well, I can do a little bit more of this, because if you look at this map, omega, defined by omega of ij is I minus A, J minus B sub I, that's in P1. which is contained in aught gamma and aught delta gamma.
Oops. Did I do that? Oops.
So I can get rid of it by composing delta with the appropriate things to get rid of the addition that we had before. Now, y'all with me? I've got some nice automorphisms there in P1. I can get rid of some of this junk. And what I get is that I can assume that delta looks just like this. Delta by J is n sub I of J. This is looking a lot better, but I still want to whittle it down a little bit more because I can. If you look at the map, ij goes to m inverse ij. This is an automorphism of zp squared. And so I can kill it off too by my useful trick. So I can assume that m is 1 and the delta looks just like this. Ij goes to I n sub I of j. And now I think it's time that we have to get our hands a little bit dirty. When we do ZPQ, we'll have to get our hands a lot dirtier. All right, so we're going to get our hands dirty, and what that means is I'm going to start to conjugate. And this is going to tell me what the n sub i's are in terms of each other. So the first thing I'm going to do is if delta is equal to that, I'm going to calculate the inverse. Well, the inverse is the obvious thing. Fixes I multiplies by n sub I inverse in the second coordinate. And I want to conjugate by the appropriate, I want to conjugate the appropriate thing. The thing I want to conjugate is tau here. The element of zp squared L that just adds one in the first coordinate. Now, I should let you know that I'm sort of cheating here. How did I know to conjugate? Why didn't I take the other one that adds one in the second coordinate? Well, the answer is, well, I did one time and it didn't really do me much good. Okay, so I'm cheating here, picking the right one because I already had picked the wrong one. So tau's in the automorphism group. Let's calculate the commutator. Tau inverse delta inverse tau delta of ij. Alright.
Okay. Did I do that again? Mm-hmm. I think I did that.
Good speed. Seems to be the projection. Maybe I should.
Not exactly.
Oh, what's that?
Exactly. Turns on. I don't think that actually had anything to do with it.
Sort of makes me feel very high. Chad.
All right. So let's look at this commutator.
Again, a little thing about this computation. How do I know to look at the commutator? It's because it gets the job done. Sometimes you don't want to get the commutator. The reason I picked it, what I want to do is I want to conjugate tau, and then I want to kill off what happens in the first coordinate. I want to map I to I in the first coordinate. So I'm picking the power of tau inverse, which will accomplish that for me. Sometimes you need to multiply by something else. So what happens? If you apply delta, of course you just multiply by n sub I in the second coordinate. I'll apply tau. I leave the second coordinate alone. I add one in the first coordinate. Now I apply delta inverse, but notice that the I has changed to an I plus 1. So instead of multiplying by n sub I inverse in the second coordinate, I'm going to multiply by n sub I plus 1 inverse. And now I multiply by tau inverse to make sure that this is I plus 0. And that gives me I, n sub I plus 1 inverse, j. Mm-hmm. All right.
Y'all, you said that. We're almost done.
So, tau and its conjugate are both in P1. So this commutator I picked is in P1. What about P1? It's a P group, right? But what about this thing? What about n sub I times n sub I plus 1 inverse? That's in ZP star. What's the order of ZP star? It's P minus 1. So whatever this thing is, it's got order relatively prime to P minus 1. So the only possible choice is just that this is the identity. And what that's going to tell me is that each of these products is the identity, and so the n sub i's are all the same. Or n sub I equals n sub I plus 1. And then a dinky induction argument tells you that all the n sub i's are the same, and that's just an automorphism of ZP cross ZP. And so ZP squared is a CI group with respect to graphs. Okay. And we didn't have to get our hands too dirty. That's why I wanted to pick this one first, so you could, it was a little gentler. When we do ZPQ, we're not going to be able to work inside a P group, obviously. And so this argument, we're actually going to have, we'll see what the conjugations are. It'll be, it's not too bad, but it's a little more complicated. All right. ZP cross ZP, what about the ZP squared? Surely some of this stuff still works.
Sort of editorial comment. What we're going to be doing is was shown by both Holzbach and Parsons in 1979 and Klein and Postel in 1981. I'm sure you remember from Misha's talk yesterday that he gave the dates 1979 and 1978. And we are both correct. I'm using the publication date. And Klein and Postel's paper was presented at a conference in 1978. So, yeah, we're both right. And the key thing to take away is that these were completely independent. The techniques are also completely different. All right. Most of the argument for ZP squared is actually exactly the same as for ZP cross ZP. You just have to check it. In fact, I don't like to work with ZP squared L at all. More accurately, I don't actually like the left regular representation. But notice that what I got things in SP with SP. Yeah, that has ground set ZP cross ZP. So I want my ground set to be ZP cross ZP. So what I'm going to do is instead of having tau just add 1, I'm going to think of it as being coordinatized. And then I'll show you that if I do it in this particular way, let tau of ij be I plus 1 in the first coordinate, and then j plus b sub I. Almost all of the b sub i's are 0 except for the last one, and it is 1. One thing about this, the important thing about that definition is that all of the b sub i's are 0 except 1. You can pick which one is non-zero. It's not going to matter at all. So let's see that this is actually a regular cyclic subgroup, and that's really that's what we need to start with. All right, so let's look at tau to the k for just any old k. It's tau to the k minus 1 of what? I plus 1, j plus b sub I. So I just applied tau. Now I'm going to just apply tau again. I'll get I plus 2 in the first coordinate, but in the second coordinate, since I moved I over 1, I don't add b sub I, add b sub I plus 1. And if you just continue this, if you raise it to the kth power, you're going to add k in the first coordinate, and then you're going to add k of these starting with b sub I. If you start, what happens if k is equal to p? In the first coordinate, you're going to have I plus 0, right? Because it's going to be I plus P.
In the second coordinate, what you're going to have is the sum of P of these things. So you're going to have the sum of all of them, which is equal to 1. And so tau to the P of ij is ij plus 1, and so this actually does have order P squared, and I can use it as my regular subgroup if I want. The argument here is actually a little bit easier in that because I'm starting with a regular cyclic subgroup, when I find my blocks of size P, they're going to be unique. So, because there's just one block system with blocks of size P instead of P plus 1. But the end is very different. So let's see. The arguments are pretty much the same. Do you remember when I killed off the n in the first coordinate here? We don't kill off the n in the first coordinate. But what you can do is make all of the m sub i's the same as before. Basically, the argument just as it was goes through. It's in it, but as I said, it's even easier because you don't have to make sure that you have the right blocks. You have the blocks you want to start with. There's a lot more of these than there are such maps that are relatively prime to P. There's P minus 1 squared of these things, and there are P minus 1 automorphisms of ZP squared star that have order P minus 1. And this is telling you that if you want it to be a CI group, you're in trouble. Okay? Other thing to notice is that that argument this solves the isomorphism problem. You have P minus 1 squared isomorphisms to check. So we're actually at the point of yawn. Who really cares if it's CI? If your point is to solve the isomorphism problem, we've got a nice solution here. I don't know if weird stuff happens. What happens if P equals 2? What about N and M? The only choices I have for them are the identity. So it's Z4 is a CI group with respect to digraphs. And actually, do you remember I was telling you that the P subgroups that we, with a vertex transitive digraph of order P squared, the CLP subgroup is either as small as possible or as large as possible. If you're looking at 2, those are the only two subgroups of S4. So it always works. You don't need any graph theory. And pretty much the exact same argument will give you that Z2 squared and Z4 are CI groups with respect to every class of combinatorial objects. And remember, we just call that a CI group. If P equals 3 and gamma is a graph, if P equals 3, the only choices I have are 1 and minus 1. What happens then is that all the choices for M and N are actually contained in the automorphism group. Because it's a graph, you know that aught gamma, it's a wreath product, you'll have aught gamma 1, wreath aught gamma 2. Gamma 1 and gamma 2 are graphs, so they both contain the reflection. And that's what, those are your only choices. Reflecting the first coordinate, reflecting the second coordinate. So Z9 is also a CI group with respect to graphs. But for digraphs, we can pick N and M to be different. Just pick N to be minus 1, M to be 1 if you like. And so for all other cases, we can choose M and N to be different for an appropriate graph or digraph. For digraphs, if you want to do the general thing, just take your gamma 1 and gamma 2 when you read them. Just take a directed cycle, read the directed cycle. That's going to have automorphism group ZP, wreath ZP. Pick your N, your M,
These are all going to be different. There's going to be P minus 1 squared different graphs. It's too many to be CI. So in all our cases, CP squared is not a CI group with respect to diagrams. But as I pointed out, in some sense, we don't care. The algorithm, the way it works, is that what? If the fixer has order P, then you're done. It's a CI digraph. If it doesn't have order P, it's a Reith product. They're isomorphic by something that looks like that. And there's a moral, sort of, to this story. One of the things I've mentioned a couple times before is Z mod ZP with ZP contains regular subgroups isomorphic to both ZP squared and ZP cross ZP. So these digraphs and graphs that we have that are not CI with respect to ZP squared, they're isomorphic to K graphs of ZP cross ZP, where it is a CI group. Yeah? So it's sort of interesting that where it's not CI, what you've done is you have a choice of group, and if it's not CI from your point of view, you picked the wrong group. Pick the elementary abelian one, not the cyclic one. This does not happen for P cubed, for what we would talk, your question, that we had that other case. Those only are circular. All right, so there's ZP squared. ZP cross ZP is, ZP squared isn't, but in some sense don't really care because it's nice, even if it's not perfect. Okay. All right, let's go ahead and start on ZQP. Same group of authors. So I'm going to let Q be less than P because they're distinct and I can do that. The basic idea is more or less the same. I'm going to, but some parts are easier, some parts are harder. I'm going to look for blocks first. Once I have blocks, I'm going to do as much as I possibly can with the Seelow theorems, and it's going to get me to a similar point, and then I'm going to start to whittle. The whittling is not going to work anywhere near as well, and so we're going to have to work a little bit harder. We'll also take a detour in the middle, because some values of Q and P are a lot nicer than other values of Q and P. And that's worthwhile seeing. So the first thing we'll do is find blocks of size P after appropriate conjugation. And in some sense, the first thing I would like to tell you about is we have blocks to start with, and we'll use a different method. There's a variety of ways of getting blocks here, but I would like to show you a very general method that's useful in many, many other contexts. So I need a definition. This is a standard permutation group definition. Let G be a group of order n. We're going to say that G is a Burnside group if whenever H is contained in the symmetric group on n, it contains G as a transitive and regular subgroup, then H is either doubly transitive or primitive. Okay. Doubly transitive or primitive. We've talked about doubly transitive. Right? If it's doubly transitive, if you've got it, remember what that means. As long as you're not stupid and try to map something on the diagonal off the diagonal, you can map any ordered pair to any other ordered pair. So you can map any arc to any other arc. And so for us, doubly transitive groups as automorphism groups, it's a trivial case. We've got a complete graph of the homology. Here's a theorem that I will not prove. You can find the proof of this, for example, in Dixon and Mortimer. An abelian group, a cyclic Celo subgroup, is a Bernstein group. I don't know if this seems does this seem like a very strong property? That somehow you can't get primitive, you go from imprimitive to doubly transitive, and to me it seems like a strong property, but in reality, Bernstein groups are extremely common. Almost all groups are Bernstein groups. This is actually, in some sense, the de facto behavior, that if you have a regular group, it's a Bernstein group. Lots and lots and lots of stuff is now known about Bernstein groups, because remember I told you that all the primitive groups are known because of the classification of fine simple groups together with the O'Nance-Scott theorem. So if you run into a group, there's an extremely good chance that it will be sorted out whether or not your group is a Bernstein group or not. So this is maybe a standard place to start. Okay. Now, but I told you I was going to do something a little different. When we apply this theorem, we're going to know that our graph is either a complete graph or it's complement, in which case we don't care, or it's primitive, but it doesn't tell us the size of the blocks. We could have blocks of size q, so there's still more work to be done to verify my claim. Okay, so let's take a Cayley digraph and see qp. We'll take a delta, we'll conjugate so that it's in the automorphism group. We're starting just like we did last time. Then this group here, the left regular representation together with its conjugate, this contains a regular cyclic subgroup, and so it's doubly transitive or primitive. Let's get rid of the doubly transitive bit. It's either a complete graph or it's complement. I can take the identity as my isomorphism. So in that case, we have a CI digraph. So we assume it's primitive, and we're also going to assume that it has a complete block system with blocks of size Q, because otherwise I've got blocks of size P, which is what I want. Now, if you solve the problems I gave, one of the problems sort of deals with something like this, with MP. When you have blocks of size, if you have MP, just like we did before, and M is smaller than P, then life is actually pretty good. You always have a normal block system if you have blocks of size P, but if you have blocks of the smaller size, you can actually always get blocks of the larger size. So let me show you how to do that. Well, P is bigger than Q. So what about a Celo P subgroup of the fixer of the block? Remember, the fixer, it's going to have order, at most, the size of SQ to the P, and the P does not divide that. Yeah, my blocks are size Q. Q is less than P, so I can't have any P elements that fix every block. So if I have an element of order P, it's got to permute the blocks somehow. But if I have blocks of size Q, what about the quotient? The quotient lives in SP, right? So if I have an element of order P in the quotient, now that's as big as I can have. So as an element of order P can't live in the fixer, the quotient lives in SP. The highest power P that divides that is P. So a Celo P subgroup of G has order P. And so now we're back to a Celo theorem type argument. I can find a gamma in G such that a Celo P subgroup of the conjugate is the same as a Celo P subgroup of this. Then this Celo P subgroup of the left regular representation, it's normal in here, because it's ZQP, it has a normal Celo P subgroup. It's normal in there, so it's normal.
And so it, we have a block system with blocks of size P.
Yeah, we have blocks of size P.
So we're going to assume script B consists of blocks of size P. What do we want to do next? We basically want to do the same thing. When I was a graduate student, it was right after I graduated, there was a big NATO conference in 1995 in Montreal, and people from all over, it was like 2 weeks, and it was very nice. There was a guy named Lewis Nowot. Have any of y'all heard of Lewis Nowot? You should have probably heard of Lewis Nowot. No. He only has 9 papers. He's sort of a large anomaly, and he's an amateur mathematician, and he's written 9 actually very nice papers. Unfortunately, his personality is such that he would not have been able to get a PhD. He doesn't like pressure, and so the exams would have killed him. But somehow or another, he kept working on this. And I met him at this NATO conference, and he eventually gave. Misha mentioned the result that he did yesterday. He showed that Z2 cross Z2 cross Z2 cross Z2 cross Z2 cross Z2 is not a CI group. He did this before I met him, and so we were talking about his proof, and he kept saying, you have to line up the rows and the columns, you have to line up the rows and the, and he did his hands like that, and with his fingers, which was very distracting, but I had no idea what he was talking about. And this was just sort of how he saw things, and many years later I realized exactly what he was talking about, is that, well, I suspect, I haven't seen him in many years, but do you remember how in the last proof I was very careful to get my block systems the same? And if you think about the Cartesian product, you can think about it in rows and columns. And so when he's saying, let's straighten out the rows and the columns, what he's basically, I think, saying is let's go and make sure that the block systems in the graph and its image are the same. So in some sense, this is exactly what I'm going to try to do. Straighten out the blocks and columns. This works pretty much the same. Except I don't really have to do much work. Because how many block systems are there? 1. So I'm not going to repeat that. We'll just assume that I can do this. That's going to give me the delta lives in SQ wreath SP. Do you remember what I did next? We looked at the quotient, and instead of saying, oops, instead of saying SP SQ here, we can conjugate and get that this is, there's 1 CELO Q subgroup in the quotient. And then we play the same thing with the kernel, and we'll get AGL1Q wreath AGL1P instead of AGL1P wreath AGL1P. Okay? And again, I'm not going to repeat this. So, what does this give us? It's going to give us the delta of ij's of mi plus a, m's of ij plus b sub I, m is in zq star, b is in zq, n sub I is in zp star, and b sub I is in z mod p. Let's whittle it down a little bit more. I'm doing things in a slightly different order than last time. I'm going to go ahead and get rid of the a, and notice I'm not messing with the b sub I's yet. So this is same idea, but I haven't established I can get rid of the b sub i's yet. So I can assume that a is 1, and if you look at this map, ij goes to mij, this is an automorphism of zqp, So I can get rid of the M and assume that it's long. And this is going to tell me that I can assume delta looks like this. Ij equals to I, n sub ij equals b sub I, and I know that the G mod script is ZQ. You might have forgotten what G is, but it's the subject generated by GL and its conjugate. Now we're going to take a bit of a detour. We're going to stop, and we're just going to say, okay, let's chuck in an extra condition and see what happens. Because something nice is going to happen. We're going to see what happens if G has a Celo Q subgroup of order Q. Now, what have we said about the Celo P subgroup so far? We used it to get blocks of size P, but that was a special case. So we haven't examined the kernel yet at all. So we don't know what size the Celo Q subgroup has. And in general, the Celo Q subgroup need not have order Q. So this is, I'm actually putting on a real additional condition here. And I'm looking at my watch, and I started at I've got 4 minutes. So let's go ahead and stop here, because the next thing I'm going to show you is going to last more than 4 minutes. But we will get something very nice out of this in this special case. And I think hopefully you will see where a very well-known result in this area comes from, the generalization of what we saw. So I'll stop here, and next time we will carry on with this assumption. Thank you.
So, questions? If not, then we have a grand.
Yeah.